I first have to say I have the best job in the whole world. So I get to do really amazing things. So my typical day, so I serve as the Associate Dean of Admissions for the School of Medicine for UCLA. In that role, I have a couple different leadership positions. So I lead the financial aid office, which works with scholarships, and we have a lot of merit and financial scholarships. So we get to, I oversee that and look at, you know, how we're going to, you know, decide who, you know, is how we're going to model those scholarships. So how are we going to divvy up the amount of money and sort of strategically look at that. I obviously oversee the admissions process for the medical school. And then something near and dear to me is I run the pathway and outreach. We call it pipeline and outreach, but it's managing our pathway programs. We have three that we do every summer. In addition, we have several across the campus. So I get to work with individuals that, like me, are interested in bringing in the next generation of diverse healthcare providers. And so I work with them. And in that role, I also get to meet with students from undergraduate campuses, give talks, talk about medical school and application. And so my day-to-day is managing those from the dean's office perspective. And then in addition, on the anesthesia part, I clinically practice obstetric anesthesia. And I love that. That is one of my passions. And I do that, you know, in the month, I will cover a few clinical days. And that really sort of brings me back to what's also important to me, which is patient care. And then in my anesthesia department, I'm the vice chair of Justice, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. And so again, I get to strategize from the clinical department side, how we really make the system more equitable and inclusive and start to work with our community in anesthesia and our department. And we have several different missions that we work on. So my typical day is really overseeing, you know, the movement and forward, you know, of our vision and our missions for each of those different groups. Lots of different meetings, strategy sessions. So each day it's a little bit different, but, you know, moving forward, the goal of diversifying the physician workforce and educating our current physician workforce on the justice, equity, diversity, inclusion issues. And I get to take care of my patients. Mentorship is really the key to success in, I think, really any career, but in medicine and in academic medicine, it's critical. And mentorship played a huge role. It played a huge role in me making the decision to, you know, do medicine after doing being in graduate school. It was mentorship from my professors, but my peer-to-peer mentorship as well was so important. And I think that one of the things that I have, I try to impart to our pathway students and to our medical students is that, you know, they come to us with some mentors and they're going to gain more and more and they're going to have a collection. And I usually on a talks I give, I display at the end of my talk, the list of all of the mentors that I've had from, you know, high school to currently, and I keep accumulating them. I think the other part that I try to talk about too is mentorship is critical, but then there's also, as you transition and move to leadership or want to transition to leadership, sponsorship is critical. And one of the things that I always point out is we think about those that are underrepresented in medicine, we often get over-mentored and under-sponsored. And I think that is something that I'm trying to impart to our community in academic medicine is that we need to, of course, continue with mentorship, but we need to do sponsorship. And that sponsorship is something that students and our residents and junior faculty really are starting to grasp how critical it is. I came to medicine with a different background. So I went through my master's in general experimental psychology and focused on social psychology, where my research was in issues around race relations, social influence, and group hierarchy. And so I came into that, and I started medical school and thought, oh, I did all of this training and I'm probably never going to use it because I don't have a biochemistry major. And it seemed like at that time, it was all about in their first year of med school about biochemistry and, cell biology. And then as I actually went through medical school and had several different experiences, students questioning, because I went to a Cal State school, I went to Cal State Northridge, and when I was at Yale for medical school, nobody knew what that was. And there was such incredible bias and, comments made that really made me feel like I didn't belong there. I started to realize, how important it was, because I was different. I was a first gen, I'm Mexican, I'm indigenous. My family did not come from the same, families that generally were at the medical school. I started to understand and use my experience from my graduate training to see how I felt very different and how important it was to bring my perspective and my lived experience. And there were so few of us that had that. Then I transitioned to residency and I realized medicine is so hierarchical. And again, I looked at, how is this, sustainable? What it takes for someone who, again, feels always very much like the outsider, because you don't quite fit into the mold of what you think of the traditional physician or how that traditional physician mold has been made in our system. And then I started to look above, and people would always ask me, well, what do you want to do in 10 years? But it's always the question. I didn't know, because I had nothing to, I had nobody to ask. I didn't really understand the system. And I was sort of learning really on the fly. But I started to look across and I saw less and less at the leadership level, people that looked like me, that had the lived experience that I had. And I started to ask the questions, why was that? And as I asked those questions, I started to think we need to change this. And as I heard the comments that would be made in, lounges and where physicians would talk, and I just thought, does anybody else hear this? Like, this is a problem. And how do we start to make a change in the system? Because I can't continue to advocate for students that look like me or have my lived experience, who are part of the communities that I come from. I can't ask them to come on board if I'm not willing to be part of that change of the system, because it's an uncomfortable space. So that's really how I started to get involved. And as I've ascended in leadership positions, my voice has been growing louder and louder, so that I can, now that I have that seat at the table, I will make those observations, discuss the issues, and try to make that change. We have lots of different groups that are working together, like-minded individuals. The way that we have to do this is we have to strategize, both in looking at the next generation of chairs and leaders in the field. And so the way to, and bringing those current chairs into the space, and a lot of education and understanding the concepts that we've sort of talked about today. I do think that, I always say we need to choose our chairs wisely, because a chair of a department can really move the force in a positive way in Jedi work. If they really lead in that way, maybe others in the department who are not very comfortable or not quite sure about adopting it, they're going to be moved by that chair and their, you know, their leadership in this. And so I think that we have to work together, you know, obviously within the JEDI communities, but we actually have to work with our leadership and really bring them up to speed on what these concepts are, what you know, we can do to kind of lead globally with the JEDI work. And we also have to strategize for our next, you know, mid-level faculty that are part of the diverse group. We have to strategize and really think about how do we develop them and thinking about what places we need to help bring them into. And it sometimes it's a matter of, you know, if a faculty has an idea of what they want to do, they're not quite sure, they need that, you know, sort of guidance and sponsorship. But I think there's a lot of momentum, and we're doing a lot to try to diversify the residency in anesthesia. We're trying to do a lot to diversify the faculty that are coming in as junior faculty. We need to pay attention to the mid-level faculty and get them to that next level. And that's where the change, that's really where the change happens. I mean, that's the whole point of leadership. Leadership is building and creating a culture. And if it falls off and that sort of pipeline breaks, and we're never going to see real change. And so right now we have to have allyship with our current leadership, both at a national level and then within our departments, the local level.